To our 14th official episode of Jesus Girl Entertainment Podcast. This is our 14th official episode for the entire podcast, but it's only our fourth episode for the season that we're in, which is pureheart.co, translated Pure Heart and Company. And the reason that we're in this season, guys, you know, we're trying to make sure that our motives are pure, that our intentions are pure with everything that it is that we're deciding that we're going to do, be it a business, be it making a new connection, be it anything. We want to make sure that our hearts are pure and that we're in alignment with God and what it is that He desires for us. And so on today, the topic that we're going to be talking from is rise above it. Yeah, that. Whatever thing it is that may be troubling you right now, rise above it. Don't play tit for tat. Don't play, you know, back and forth. Rise above it. And so being the bigger person, that was something that I struggled with for years. I'm not going to say it's just so much easy now, but because I know the result of not being a bigger person, I am more likely to take the higher route. Just because I don't want the consequences that follow with going in the opposite direction. And so the reason that we're talking about this today is because when you're stepping out on faith, when you're doing anything that's beneficial, when you're doing anything that's progressive, anything that's successful, you're gonna be met with opposition. And we discussed this before. It may not always be from things. You may have opposition from people. But we're not in a place where we want to go back and forth with people. We want to try to prove them wrong. We got to get the last word. We got to, you know, we just can't do it. This is not, you'll exhaust too much energy trying to prove people wrong when God is trying to take you up. He's taking you higher and you still trying to be in a low place by trying to go back and forth with people that he's delivered you from. And so two or three days ago, I saw a duck on my roof. And this was odd for me because I'm used to seeing them walking, you know, on the ground, or I'll see them in the pond. But to actually be on my roof, that was something that was new. And so I really researched. I went on Google. I was like, why would a duck be on my roof? And what I discovered is that they usually will fly onto a roof if they're trying to avoid their predators, or so that they can have it'll be easier for them to observe their surrounding areas. And that was learning tool for me, even learning lesson for me, even, because at least you mean to tell me a duck have enough sense to know that if something is on the same level of me trying to hurt me, I need to go above it. I need to get higher than it. And so that's what I really want us to talk about today. Not only that, I want you to be encouraged if you may have fallen short of that recently, or if you just continue to fall short of that, because it's a learning process. But I do, you know, you guys, I don't never want to present a problem without presenting a solution as well, because there are ways for you to be able to maneuver around that and able to overcome your flesh, or able to overcome your anger and rise to the place of spiritual maturity that God desires for you. And so a long time ago when I was in, not a long time ago, come on now. But anyways, when I was in high school, one of the most popular things that was, not even popular, but it was just a big deal, was getting your driver's license, getting your permit. And so a lot of my classmates, they went, and y'all know on Soul Food, Soul Care Sundays, we just kind of just, we came back and we talk about those things. And so we're just having a conversation. Well, it's not a dialogue, because we're not going back and forth, but I'm just sharing. So you guys can not, I don't want you to feel like you're by yourself in anything. So pick me. Okay, I'll go. I'll tell you guys something so that you don't feel like you're by yourself in these struggles. So anyways, getting your license, getting your permit was a huge thing. So when it came time for me to get my license, my permit, my mom and my stepdad, they purchased me a gold Cadillac. That was my first car, all gold Cadillac Broham. It was a big car and it was beautiful. I'm not going to tell y'all that, because that was my first car. By the end of me having that car, it was completely wrecked. But anyways, let's stay focused. Let's stay on track. So everybody was going to get their permits, and my classmates, they were like, oh, it's common sense. It's common sense. They passed it on the first time. Now, many of them went to school. They went to a driver's school, but I didn't have the luxury of going there. So many, you'd be surprised at all the people that taught me how to drive. I mean, everywhere from the local this, the local that, my grandmother, my mother, you know, ultimately, I ended up being taught how to drive by my boyfriend at that time. And so I didn't learn the professional way or the proper way of how to drive. I just knew, like, I learned how to drive based upon instinct. You know, go this way, do this speed level, you know, how to merge onto different things, how to drive on the highway, just basic stuff. But I didn't know, like, rural roads and how fast you should go on this kind of road and how you should turn on this kind of street. And so when I got ready to go and do my permit test, I failed it my first time. And so because I was like shocked, because everybody said it was common sense, I'm like, wow, I don't have common sense. So I'm like, no, I got to take this test again. So I went back to go and take it again. Second time, failed it again. Third time failed. Fourth time failed. Fifth time, I said, maybe I need to do something different. I'm telling you guys, five times failed it. No. So I went and I told somebody at school, I finally admitted, like, I'm failing this test. And they said, oh, they have a book. So the BNV was offering a book. And I got the book. I read it a little bit. And then I got online and I started doing some pretests. So I went back to take it again, sixth time, failed again. So now I'm really like bombed out. Like, I keep failing this test. And so finally, the seventh time, when it was time for me to take it the seventh time, and you guys, you can ask my mom. She was the one who was taking me back and forth. I finally all night, studying. Got online, study. Did the pretest. I went in and I passed it. So I could have been discouraged at the first time, the second time, the third time. I said, I'm not going to do it anymore because I feel stupid because everybody else said it's common sense and they're getting it and they're passing on the first time. And here I am failing it every single time I go out to try to take it. But the lesson that I learned in that, and that's something I want to help you guys with on today, is that what may come naturally for somebody, it may take some work for you. It may require some hard work for you. I had a little brother, y'all know I like to share. When we were little, we had one of those households that we roasted each other. We play fought. We did, you know, we just had that kind of family. And so one of my brothers, he started to gain weight rapidly. And we were like, we used to tease him, like talking about him and stuff like that. And he used to tease us. Okay, so my brother, I have one brother that's extremely light skinned. And so he was very, very light. And I was dark and my brother was brown. And so he teased us about us being dark, but we teased him about his weight. And so one day, I guess he got fed up with it and he started hitting the track. And then one day he just walked in and we was like, Shake Man, when you get skinny? We was really, really shocked that he said he had started going to the track and he had joined the track team. So after he joined the track team, my brother following him decided he was going to join the track team too. Why am I sharing all of these lessons, okay? All of these things that happen in life. Because as I said a few minutes ago, is that what may come naturally for somebody may require you some work. But the best way for you to even stop a critic is not only to overcome the area that they're talking about you in, but to rise above it. So one way that we can rise above those issues or those areas in our life that need help, let's say I'm struggling with my anger, I'm struggling with whatever other area you may be struggling in, is to study. You have to study. Bible says, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needed not to be ashamed. You can apply this to several areas of your life, but especially apply to the area in your life that you are definitely in need of God to come and help you in. So if I'm struggling with my temper, if I'm struggling with lust, or I'm struggling with whatever other thing that I'm struggling with, we don't have to walk around and say, oh, this is just a hard issue for me, because there's a remedy for that in the Word of God. Somebody broke it down, and it was a good way to break it down, is basic instructions before leaving earth. That's what they said that the acronym is for the Bible. And so if every single thing that you're struggling with is in there, and if you don't know exactly where to go to find whatever you need to find, Google is so popular now. I know they have other search engines that people use, but you can Google Bible verses about anger, Bible verses about lust, Bible verses about dealing with betrayal, Bible verses about dealing with gossip. That was one of the hardest ones for me to overcome, because I never understood how people can get together and just spend a whole conversation with talking or tearing somebody else down. Like, I've never been cut that from that cloth. If you ask any of the people that I communicate with on a day-to-day basis, it is never, our conversations is definitely about moving forward, definitely about pushing a purpose, definitely about how to get a business, some type of form of networking, me encouraging them or them encouraging me, because I don't have the time or the energy to just sit and try to, you know, tear somebody else down. But some people do. That's the level that they're on. And if they just decide that you're going to be the topic for their discussion, in order for us to really get to where it is that God wants us to be, just because you're making me a topic and you're saying these negative things about me, I can't go back and forth with you. I can't come down from where I'm at and try to prove you wrong. Because the reality is, some people are more willing to run with the lie than they are willing to run with the truth. they can hear a lie, and then once the truth is revealed, they'll keep on saying, nah, that ain't real. Just like with the man in the Bible who was blind. And the Pharisees asked, whose fault was it? Was it the mom's or was it the father's? And then it was revealed that it was nobody's fault, but for the glory, well, not the Pharisees, the disciples asked this to Jesus. Was it the mom's or the father's fault? And he said it was nobody's fault, but for the glory of God to be revealed. But as the Pharisees seen, and he said, you know, I was blind, but now I can see. They didn't believe it. They want to ask his parents. His parents said, yeah, he was born blind. I mean, we don't know what happened with him. Ask him. He grown enough to tell you. Some people, they're more apt to believe the broken or the flawed state of you than they are to believe the healed or the whole state of you. And you can't tell them. And this season, you just gonna have to show them. This not the tell them season. It's not the tell them off, get them right season. You're gonna exhaust so much energy, and then you're giving people free press. You're never gonna get free press on my platform, on my page. I'm not gonna give you free press, because there's a media statement, and I'm not so much into that, but I'm really big on my presentation and what it is that I'm presenting to the world. I'm not going to take 10, 20, 30 minutes of my life to put something together, tag your name or whoever's organization, and draw everybody that way so they can be playing ping pong between the pages to try to figure out, no. And that's not what we're pushing. And 1 second, and I heard somebody say this, but I don't know exactly the wording to say, so I'm just going to put it in my own words. You can build something in 5 years and destroy it in 5 seconds with a moment. It's not to say that we're, you know, without flaw or without frailty, but we should be becoming more and more mature daily, weekly, especially if you know that people are coming for you. If you know that people are plotting against you, David was the king and they were still coming from him, for him. But he knew to cry out to God to help him with what it is that they were trying to do against him. He couldn't come down to the people and just start trying to take them out because he was skilled at war, because he was equipped to do it. He couldn't just do that. We saw what happened when he did try to usurp his authority to take someone's wife and life. God punished him. God has elevated you to a place of authority. He has elevated you to a place of prominence, to a place of purpose, to a place of impact. And you're willing to get in trouble with him to come down and try to prove somebody right? He already proven them right. You think that they talking just because you ain't doing nothing? You think they have something to say because they don't see your potential? No, they're talking because they can see it. They're talking because, and then this is what just keeps coming to me, is that you're influencing them. The higher you go, it may seem like, oh, they're just trying to comfort you, but really, that may be their fear speaking out against you because your shining, your light kind of intimidates them. Just imagine the man at the pool of Bethesda. We don't get more, you know, background on what happened with the other people around him. But once he got up and he started to walk, imagine all the people who had been with him for that 38 years, seeing them struggle. People have seen you struggle. People have seen you, you know, dibble and dabble in different things. People have seen you lose your temper. When I was younger, my temper was so bad, my skin would literally feel as if it was heat coming from my skin if somebody made me mad. And I just have to fight this person because they came for me. When I think about it, it's so unrealistic now, but I remember actually being in those moments. But the fact that now when I think about it, it sounds so unrealistic means that there is some growth that has taken place. When God has invested in you, he's expecting to see the fruit, not the gift. Jesus cursed the fig tree, as beautiful as it was, because it was gifted. The leaves, I heard a preacher give this illustration. I'm just going to piggyback off what they said, that the leaves represented the gifts, but there were no fruit underneath there. So he saw the gift, but it didn't have any fruit. Your gift will get you in the room. And this is just something that came to me. Your gift will bring you before great men, make room for you and bring you before great men. But it's going to be your fruit, your character that keeps you there. I was watching a movie called Time with Justin Timberlake. And in the movie, the waitress asked him, you're not from here, are you? he had come up, I mean, came up on a lot of time. At that time, the time was current. The time in that movie, the time was the currency. So as we spend money, it was time. And the waitress asked him, "You're not from here, are you?" And then he said, I don't remember exactly how he replied. I don't even want to get the man wrong. But in so many words, he said he wasn't. And she's, or maybe he said, "How can you tell?" And her response was, "Because you do everything a little bit too fast." He had come into a new place in a new environment. He was qualified to be there. He had money like they did. But because he had not yet been reprogrammed, because he hadn't taken any lessons on how to operate on that level, he was still using some old street tactics in a completely different arena. One thing that we can learn from my mistakes, from my failing that test so many times, is that every failure I learned a lesson, and every failure I got closer to passing it. And this season, use the failures that you experienced before, because yeah, it may have hurt at that time. Maybe you failed at a relationship, maybe you failed at a network, maybe you failed at a connection, maybe you failed in different things. But what did you learn from it? Use those lessons, because it's going to help you on your next level. It's going to help you. Just like if you play like a game like Mario, I don't know. They playing these new games now. But back then we had more innocent games, I feel. But Mario or Sonic, when you get to another level, then it's more challenging courses that you have to pass. But you're still able to use those skills that you learned in the other level. You can use the skills that you have learned, but make sure that we're just not skillful, we're just not gifted, but we actually have fruit. So once people get close to us, it's not an exposure. That's what's killing a lot of ministries, a lot of businesses, a lot of different things, a lot of celebrities. We fall in love with the gift, oh, and then when something come out about their personal life, oh my gosh, we just cannot believe it. And many times we thrown away. Sometimes we give them grace. And sometimes some things they do just can't come back from it. Rise above it. Rise above it, them, that, whatever it is. God is here to help you. He has given us his word to help us to maneuver through these things that may be trying to keep us in a place of stagnancy. I don't want that for me, and I don't want it for you. I don't want it for none of us. We've exhausted the other level. It just, when I was getting ready to, okay, so I ended up going to a night school called Martin Luther King Academy. They closed it, and I hate that they did that, because it was really a good, it was great for us, those who were not getting all of our credits. You had to pay a certain amount of money to be able to get the credits there. But when you went there, it was some of everybody. And it was some people in there that was way overaged. I mean, not even in their teens anymore, that were taking classes. But nobody was judging anybody because, you know, we were all there trying to get our, you know, collect our credits. But when you're in a place that you outgrown, I give a perfect example. My daughter, she came to me today. She said, mommy, she only put some shoes on her, but the shoes were too small. And I was like, and she was distressed about this. She really want to wear these shoes. And I'm like, you know, these are too small for you. Some things are too small for you. You going to argue with them about that? You going to go back and forth with them about that? That's too small. That's outdated. This the same test representing itself. And you have to grow and rise above it in love. I'm not going to argue with you, sister so-and-so. I'm not going to go back and forth with you, brother such and such. I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to pray for God to help me to love you. And I'm going to speak life to you. Even though you're trying to, you know, tear me down, I'm going to speak life to you. Because in so doing, I'm honoring God. And he can be glorified in my life. We've outgrown that, guys. There are great things on the horizon. And people are getting it. There are people that, cha-ching, getting it. And we don't want to miss it. So that's all I have for you guys for this Soulful Soul Care Sunday. Rise above it. Let God be glorified in your life. Let them talk. Let them do whatever they're going to do. You stay focused. Just keep your hand to the plow. Continue doing what it is that God has called you to do, because there is a sure reward. A sure reward. If you don't faint, if you don't fall, if you don't give up, let's rise. Let's get up. We're going higher. Dear most gracious Father, how I thank you and praise you for this opportunity to allow me to speak on this podcast. I pray now in the name of Jesus that every word that was spoken, Father, that it bring forth fruit. God, forgive us for not being willing to forgive those who have sinned against us and asking you to forgive us. Father, we repent of it. We repent of even harboring anything in our spirits that's not like you. We pray now in the name of Jesus that you begin to mature us into where it is that you are taking us so that you can be glorified in our lives. I lift up every one of my brothers and sisters in Christ, all of the people around the world that are even listening into this podcast, that you may equip them, that you may even heal them in those areas that they've been betrayed, they've been hurt, they're dealing with some soul wounds. They really need you to show up in their lives, Father. I pray that you heal them in those areas so that they can be fully able to love, to bless those that curse them. Pray for those that despitefully use them. Father, we thank you and we praise you for being all powerful, all knowing. We know that you know all things. So instead of us thinking that too highly of ourselves and more higher than ourselves than we are, we give it over to you. We give it over to you, God. We cast this care upon you because we know that you care for us. And in us casting it upon you, Father, you said that the meek shall be exalted. We humble ourselves before you and we say we can't do it by ourselves. And we pray that in this season that you help us to walk into our blessed place, our promised place, the things that you have promised before time, that we begin to even experience it now. In the mighty and matchless name of Jesus, we do seal this prayer. And we thank you, God, for all that you're going to do and all that you've already done. Hallelujah and amen.
A call that resounds in my ear. It's calling me deeper, breaks every fetter and removes all my fears. It's calling me deeper. You see the place that I need can no longer contain my destiny. It gets cold as it's rain, but I adhere to the call inside of me. It's calling me deep, deep, deeper. It's calling me deeper, deeper, deeper. Oh.
There is a call that resounds in my ear.
Calling me.
It's calling me deeper.
So much deeper.
Deeper.
And
it breaks everything.
Calling me deeper, so much
deeper.
See the place that I'm in
can no longer contain my destiny.
Ooh.
And there's no destiny, but I'm here to go.
my destiny. Though it may have some pain, I adhere to the call inside of me. It's calling me deeper.